We've heard earlier from Fitch Ratings. Now let's talk to one of the six digital banks in the country, which has cornered the second biggest market share among peers in terms of deposits. Union Digital's president and CEO Henry Aguda joins us live. Henry, hi. Good morning. Welcome to Market Edge.
Good morning, Mimi, and good morning to all of your viewers.
All right. Henry, we want to begin by rolling this soundbite from Fitch Ratings about what they described as the limited impact that digital banks have had on traditional banks. Let's listen to this.
If we take a look at some of the data as of June, you know, we're looking at an aggregate market share of around 0.4%. So that is very minuscule in the greater scheme of things, but that also reflects relatively quite nascent profile of these digital banks. You know, a lot of them have actually only started operations within 1 year. So I think it is quite likely that we are going to see this market shares continuing to grow upwards, you know, as given their high growth aspirations. Even with kind of like 20-30% growth rate, you know, their market share will remain relatively small. And secondly, I guess if you take a look at some of the strategy that they, some of the banks are employing, i.e. those that are relying so much on the pricing to get customers, we don't think that is going to be sustainable in the long run. So there will be some sort of moderation going forward, and also a moderation in growth rate as well. In terms of, we were talking about the APAC market, I think it will be across the board. You know, if you take a look at China, who has had digital banks for more than 10 years, you know, in a greater scheme of things, you know, their market shares is less than, you know, 1 or 2%. And we have banks in Korea who have made quite a bit of inroads, you know, into the personal unsecured space. But in the greater scheme of things as well, you know, they are not the top five players, right? You know, in the case of Philippines, I think it will be similar. You know, I think in the case of Philippines, it will be even more so in terms of because the way that the kind of customers that they're targeting, it's relatively different than what the incumbents are going after. You know, so we will see quite a bit of a limited overlap.
Henry, your thoughts about the limited impact?
Yeah, so I totally agree. We're a young industry right now in terms of it's a nascent industry right now. I agree that right now we're in the early days. Just to put it in perspective, the digital banks are still about, you know, almost about a year in operations. But in a year that it was, we've already onboarded, as of close of June, as official number, 3.5 million in digital customers. We already have a loan book of about $1 billion. And, you know, from a very young industry, the growth is very robust. In the world, there are only close to around 400 neo digital banks. And the average for a neo or a digital bank to become profitable takes between 3 to 4 years. And most of the six digital banks are on track. Just to give some confidence building measure for some investors, Union Digital actually is ahead of that average number of years in terms of becoming profitable. So as an industry also, we've come together. We have the Digital Bankers Association of the Philippines. We call ourselves DBA. And we've banded together because we know it's a community play. And as young as we are in terms of our company profile, we're trying to come together to help one another to boost the mandate that we've been given to onboard the unbanked and the underbanked. And I think we're making an impact in the scheme of things in the whole banking industry. I mean, it may just be a rounding error for some, but you can just imagine the growth in the next 2 to 3 years.
Mm-hmm. So Henry, let's talk about Union Digital in 2024. You did say that you're ahead of the pack in terms of market share and profitability. Are you going to be profitable by 2024? How are you targeting to grow your, for example, your deposits and loan book next year?
Well, by 2024, definitely we'll be profitable. We're racing to close 2023 to either break even or be really positive already by end of this year. But 2024, we're sure to be on track to become profitable. our parent bank, Union Bank, has actually provided us additional funding to grow our capital. And it's good capital because it's capital not to backstop for losses, but it's capital to drive our revenue and our top line. And to give you some idea, I think from 23 to 24, we expect to grow between 3 to 4 times in our lending revenue. And with that, hopefully our income grows at the same pace.
All right. Exciting, exciting times ahead. I wonder, you know, let's shift gears a little bit and talk about the technology. You do belong to the Aboitiz Techglomerate. You guys have been leading the charge in some cutting-edge technology, data science, data. And I know, for example, you guys participated in the Singapore FinTech Festival, the recently held Singapore FinTech Festival. What are some of the amazing technologies that you're working on right now? I've seen a lot of people post about how the president spoke to the group via a hologram. Was that your work?
Well, it's a combination of a lot of people, Union Digital, our parent bank, Union Bank, and some of the people who thought about innovation in the larger Aboitiz Techglomerate group. So it was actually a coup that was pulled off. Was nobody thought that we'd be able to pull off a hologram, considering the busy schedule of the president at that time. So the Singapore FinTech Festival happened, as you know, during the APEC. And how do we bring the president into places at the same time? The hologram presented itself as a solution. And we used holo projectors projected on a holo net mesh, 3.5 by 3.2 meters in size. And we simulated his 3D presentation in that space. And it turned out fantastic. So he is the first head of state that did a keynote in a hologram manner in the biggest fintech festival in the world. Actually, Singapore FinTech Festival broke the record in terms of attendees last November. It's close about 70,000 participants, around 900 speakers, and about 2,000 regulatory and government representatives there. That hologram was picked up by close to 70 to 80 news agencies, both locally and in the region. So it was a fun project that showcased the Philippines' ability to innovate, not just in the fintech space, but in technology in general.
Mm-hmm. And aside from being a fun project, is there a business use case for this hologram technology? Will your consumers and subscribers be able to experience this in one way or another when they do digital banking with you guys?
Well, you know, it's a, how should I call it? It's a fun experiment. It's a sandbox. But you can just imagine one of these days going into a branch and instead of a live teller coming in, it's a hologram. Or you can have your own avatar and project yourself in the metaverse. And you know, Union Bank is the first bank to experiment with metaverse banking.
Mm-hmm. How's that coming along, the metaverse banking?
Well, we have to do digital banking first before we take it to the next level. But you know, that's showing you that we plan to be 2-3 steps ahead of innovation. It's not going to be mainstream in 2024, but it's something that keeps us moving forward, especially in the space of doing something new and at the edge of trying to make customer experience as fun and as engaging and as exciting as possible.
And as efficient as possible. You know, as much as tech brings good, it also brings some harm along the way. We know how online fakery through deep fakes, misinformation, make for a scary mix for digital banks. I mean, I remember no less than the Citigroup had called the combination of mobile banking and social media a game changer for bank stability. How are we doing? How are digital banks here preparing for, you know, a possible surge of fake transactions, hackings perhaps? Are you seeing improvement in the way we detect hacks and these fake attempts? And maybe, you know, everyone's saying artificial intelligence could actually work for our side, turn the tide on cyber criminals, can help you guys.
So the answer is yes. There have been advances in technology, but it's not just the banking space or the private sector. It's also in collaboration with the government. So we have the national ID, the SIM registration, In fact, there are bills in both the House and the Senate right now for anti-mule and, blocking of illegal sites, which will not impact just the banking sector, but also the creative sector. So everything's coming together. The nice thing is, I think technology is off the shelf. Everybody has access to technology nowadays, the hackers as well as the people running financial institutions. It's the community play. I think more and more we will see a watershed in history where banks and financial institutions are now collaborating to fight cyber threat and cyber fraud. And more, the private and the public sector are coming together to create the right policies to do so. So technology is there. It's just a matter of how we effectively use them as a community to fight the threats. I think of late, because of the SIM registration app, we've improved in terms of scams that are out there. It has lessened, but, cyber criminals are always pushing the edge in terms of technology. Some of them are using AI already. So there's an initiative right now to also use AI to combat them.
Mm-hmm. All right. And you guys are going to be at the forefront. Thank you very much, Henry, for joining us, the tech story of Union Digital. We look forward to news that you guys are hitting your goals for next year. Very, very busy and exciting year ahead. Thank you again for joining us. Have a great week ahead.
Thank you, Mimi.